Hello everyone, welcome back. We're going to do another White Gloves of Destiny, another lucky dip into the card catalogue. We are joined by Hannah Fry, famous mathematician, perhaps most famous for appearing in Numberphile videos.
Almost certainly.
You've probably seen her in lots of TV shows and things, but also top class mathematician. But how lucky is she? We're about to find out.
Okay.
Where are you going? Right. I hope your eyes are closed.
Okay, and they definitely are.
Start with a draw.
Okay.
Right over there.
There's one.
Okay, so we have Edward Sabine, referee reports by J.B. Airy on some of his papers. Let's choose the lunar tide one and the magnetism one.
So there was an Airy who did a lot of fluid dynamics stuff.
Oh, okay.
And if we're talking lunar tides, there's a chance this could be one of the people who I've studied before.
Okay.
I mean, I'm not holding out much hope.
It's all right. It's okay, Hannah, because even if that's boring, you are allowed a backup, a provisional. So do you want to do a second one for us, just in case?
Yeah, go ahead. Okay, I'm going to go over here this time.
All right, over the other side. Okay, there we go. Don't pull it too far.
Sorry, I'll end up on the floor.
Yeah, all right, find a card.
Let's go for that one.
This is British Museum. It's a letter that's been written by children to the Duke of Sussex. We have no idea what this is about.
That could be intriguing.
Now we go down into the archives and find out what you got. You ready?
Yeah.
Let's do it. All right then, here we are. Lead the way.
Which one's up first? Is the Airy papers, is this?
That's right, yeah.
So this is like his peer review, is it?
That's right. These referees' reports are early peer reviewing.
Okay.
So from 1832, and you've chosen the very first volume, which is this one here.
So I did a cheeky thing on the way down. I Googled Airy.
Because
if it was the one that I knew.
Biddell Airy, very important. Yeah, yeah.
And it is the one that I've done some
indeed,
stuff.
Yeah.
So he came up with an equation. That's what I know him from.
Yeah. He was Astronomer Royal as well. So he was based in Greenwich. Edward Sabine is the other character involved. Sabine was president of the Royal Society. So it's a letter between two
very big
deals. 19 scientists.
Ooh, okay.
Let's go have a look. So this is 1847, and we can see here George Biddell Airy is writing from the Royal Observatory, Greenwich, March 3rd.
Gosh, that's hard to read. I have read carefully W. Cole Sabine's, paper.
Lieutenant Colonel Sabine.
My bad. On the
diurnal variation of the magnetic declination at St. Helena.
Of course. Ah. And I have smashed...
Remarked.
That does legit look like smashed.
Remarked with
many
very great interest, the nature of the observations and methods employed in it.
Mm-hmm.
I consider this to be one of the most important with regard to terrestrial magnetism that has yet been obtained.
Well.
So this is a pretty good report.
Normally when you have a peer review, there's that nice bit at the top and then there's pages and pages of really niggly comments.
Yeah, all the spelling mistakes. And
Your figure, I just want you to change it ever so slightly in a way that will take 6 months worth of work.
Yep. But this is, go ahead and print it.
So Hannah, as an academic, this is something you should be cherishing. This is a glowing referees report.
I know. Okay. They are rare.
So here's Airy again, writing, it's actually on the same day. And it's actually...
Is it the same paper?
Almost completely the same, yes.
Different paper this time.
On different paper, yes. Right. So Sabine's written two papers into the Royal Society for publication in Field Trans. So it's on the tide at St Helena in this case. So it recommends the paper to be printed again.
So basically...
Slam dunk.
Mm-hmm. They've both been sent to the same person for review.
Yep.
And he's written the same review saying, cracking paper.
Pretty much. Love it. On the same day, he's read two papers flat out, clearly. And giving a thumbs up.
Let's see what your provisional was like, because this is good.
What do you reckon this gets out of 10, Brady?
6.
Okay, I think that's...
6.
Yeah, actually, I think
I thought about it.
It's a bit generous.
All right, okay.
So we have MS-122.
Mr. Evans in the Royal Society, 1831.
So this is the letter by John George Children. It's among this volume of Evans' letters. Let's turn a few pages and just see what the correspondence relates to. So this is to do with balloting for election to the fellowship, I think. And this appears to be
the candidate
was... Blackballed.
Blackballed.
Blackballed. Yep.
Drama.
So
this is a bit of gossip then. This is a little bit of gossip.
This is.
So is it that you get one blackball and you're out? anybody says no, everyone gets a veto.
Yep, you can have a veto on these things. And we do, as Brady knows, we have a mechanism for doing that.
I tell you what, as a special objectivity treat for Hannah, I'm going to go and get something.
Yep.
Because I know where it is.
Who's children then?
So he's a Royal Society secretary.
Okay.
So he's clearly responsible here for the process of election. And Evans has not been elected and is fairly upset about it. I assume
so. Evans is writing to complain.
Well, this is a correspondence on the case. Now, you selected this letter, and this is J.G. Children writing to His Royal Highness the Duke of Sussex. Duke of Sussex is president of the Royal Society at this time. So, a peremptory but anonymous demand from persons calling themselves the friends of Mr. Evans, having been placed in my hands, I might perhaps be inclined to obey so extraordinary a mandate were I not desirous to terminate a business certainly of a painful nature, but which originated, as far at least as your highness is concerned, in mere misapprehension, and also to tranquillize the feelings of a gentleman.
That's a long sentence.
It is, yeah. Which, it seems, I have been the unintentional cause of having been disturbed. On this account, I am ready to repeat what I said to Dr. Paris, that I did not...
Underlined.
And could not...
Underlined.
...intend to intimate anything of an odious, underlined, nature against Mr. Evans, of whom I have neither entertained, received, or imagined any such impression I have the honour to be.
Oh, this is a proper storm.
Scandal.
And there's like a Friends of Evans group, and like, there's like campaign groups.
Okay, so Evans was nominated and then blackballed, and then his friends complained about it. Children tried to respond and then was accused of being
insulting. Yeah.
That is good.
Yes. All right, and now it's time for the tree. I'll bring it around.
Okay. Is this the real one?
So here we go. This is a voting machine, and we can explain a bit about blackballing here.
So you have a black ball and a white ball.
Oh.
So you're holding the black and the white, and say we were voting for should Brady be a fellow of the Royal Society? And you can go, two ways we could vote here. We could do a yes and a no, or another way of voting is if you've got the white ball and the black ball and you're in a room full of other fellows, you can just put your hand in.
And no one can see.
No one can see which ball you're dropping. Oh, blackballed.
I was actually nice to you.
Oh, look, she kept the blackball. I'm in.
Yeah, you're still not a fellow, Brady.
I thought when we first pulled that letter out that you'd failed, Hannah. I thought you'd got a boring one. But you've got a lovely little bit of gossip behind the scenes. All the scuttlebutt, all the stuff going on at the Royal Society.
Unsuccessful fellowship election.
I know, the scandal. To be fair, though, there's two things. Airy and his nice equation and a bit of gossip. That's me done. I'm happy with that.
That's good.
Good work.
Yeah.
Good work.
Did the job.
To Daniel Ross Esquire, Commander of the Honourable East India Company ship Discovery, in testimony of the sense entertained of the manly and important services, manly and important services, okay, rendered by him in contribution to the rescue of the American ship Asia of Philadelphia.